You know what you're listening to? You're listening to the Deen Team, bringing the light of Islam right into your hearts.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome our listeners to another episode. You're listening to the Deen Team with your host, your brother in Islam, Malaz, and I've got a very special guest with me today. I have with me Sheikh Wissam Chikawi. And welcome to the show, Sheikh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I think this is the first time that you come onto our show, or have you been on before?
I think I've been on the radio, the same radio station, possibly on a different show, but
alhamdulillah.
I've heard your show before and I enjoy it.
Alhamdulillah. We're looking forward to hearing from you today, and inshallah we're looking forward to having you later on, you know, on our show once again, inshallah. Sheikh, how's your Ramadan? I mean, this is a beautiful time. We've had about, you know, one third of Ramadan passed already. How's your Ramadan so far?
I think it's always a privilege to have the opportunity to be present in Ramadan. And alhamdulillah, when we reflect upon what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, yani the dua that he made in Sha'ban, about that his ummah be present in the coming month of Ramadan, and that he was anxious about it. So I definitely think it's a privilege when we reflect on the statements of the Prophet, and I think that we really are bestowed or have been really showered with Allah's blessings to be present in this month.
Alhamdulillah, wallahi, this is a beautiful month, a beautiful bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I mean, we want to speak about something that's specific to this month. It goes around all year, but it's got some sort of special, you know, meanings within this month of Ramadan, which is the maghfirah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all know the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, awaluhu rahmah, first of part of Ramadan is mercy, awsatuhu maghfirah, and we are in the days of maghfirah, forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa akhiruhu i'tqu min an-nar, the end of it is salvation from the hellfire, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he gives us and grants us his salvation from hellfire. So Sheikh, I mean, what's significant about this maghfirah within the month of Ramadan?
The thing that's significant is, and I think if we look at the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we see that there are special times and special days in Islam. For example, Friday is a special day where there's a special time on Friday that if you catch that time and you make that dua, it's accepted.
Allahu Akbar.
We also know that if a person, he makes dua, for example, before futur, that again, that dua at that time is accepted. So we know, as the Prophet has told us, we can see through these evidences that there are special times where if a person makes dua, it's accepted. Now the Prophet is informing us that this middle part of Ramadan, this is a special time. It's a time where a person, he can seek forgiveness from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah. Just like Friday, there's a special time on Friday. The Prophet is informing us there's also a special time within Ramadan. Allah can obviously hear our istighfar at any time, but this is particularly special. Particularly special because it's come on the tongue of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And so this really is of great significance. Of great significance. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's door is open. Now, O people, O ibadi, if you want to come closer to me, if you want to renew your relationship with me, refresh your relationship, this is the time now. I'll forgive you, I'll pardon you. And the Prophet is saying, this is a great opportunity. And this is the time in which the Prophet informed us about.
Allahu Akbar. Sometimes we think about, I mean, maghfirah and, you know, forgiveness, seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you think, I mean, كل ابن آدم خطأ. All humans make mistakes. All humans have sin in their life. I mean, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins.
No.
I mean, if someone feels that he's you know, been neglectful towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's sinned for a very long time, how does one approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask for forgiveness in this month?
I think this is best answered with the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But if a person, because sometimes a person, see, he thinks that he can't approach Allah because he's got so many sins.
Subhanallah.
But I think if we look carefully at the words of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that even if a person whose sins were to fill بلغت عينان السماء, that his sins were to reach the sky, and in another narration fill the earth, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would match those sins with forgiveness. So I think in that regard, I think knowing who Allah is, look, it's a time that we get to know Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and if you know that Allah will forgive sins, you will have no hesitation to approach. Absolutely no hesitation. And I think it's an important aspect that when we learn about the hadith and we really ponder about the hadith, there will be no hesitation in coming to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And this is what it's all about. And Allah wants you to come forth to Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He, the door is open. But really, it just takes that person to make the first step.
So, I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no sin too large for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive. I mean, no matter how much sin we have in our life, no matter how much we've neglected Allah, neglected our deen, neglected our relationship with the Qur'an, you know, we neglected the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I mean, this is a perfect time to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Absolutely. Look, if a person does not commit shirk with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the forgiver of sins except shirk. Allah has clearly told us in the Quran that everything He will forgive except shirk if a person were to ask. And this is what it is about. And there's so much evidence within the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the forgiving, is the one who forgives. And it's just interesting, يعني, I was يعني, going through the names of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and I was reminded of the name of Al-Halim. You know, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Al-Halim. And there were many people who had come up with you know, the best translation of what the name Al-Halim is. And there was one translation that really caught my eye. And it was one that basically that means the ever-relenting. The ever-relenting. What that basically means is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forbears. يعني He sees the person, He commits the sin. The person keeps committing the sin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forbears that. Doesn't punish him straight away. He forbears that. And what happens is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He makes manifest His signs to that individual in an effort to bring that person back to tawbah.
Subhanallah.
So this is Al-Halim, the ever-relenting, or some have said the mild, or some of the, or the or clement, the one who provides clemency. You see that Allah, He makes His signs manifest, but He forbears that person's sins. Why? Because He wants to lead him back to tawbah. He wants to bring him back. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawwabin." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who come back to Him. Loves those who make repentance. Loves those who repent to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. No, there is no sin too great for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive. And we must realize that about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. If we're only dealing with one mercy upon earth that Allah has given us, and Allah has reserved the rest on the Day of Judgment, then subhanallah, subhanallah. And He is more merciful than a mother is to her child.
Allahu Akbar.
So we are dealing with a creator who is the most merciful.
Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, this is the month of Quran, and I mean, we've been listening, praying the Taraweeh and having the attachment with the book of Allah, and we read in many of the ayat, Allahu Ghafurun Rahim, Allahu Ghafurun Rahim. I mean, you mentioned Al-Halim. What are the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you know, indicate His forgiveness subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of His names is Al-Ghafar, which basically occurs in the Quran more than 17 times. And basically Al-Ghaffar, which is the word relevant to that, is Ghaffara. Now the word Ghaffara means to conceal or cover. To conceal or cover. And when you apply that in a technical point of view, it means what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. So Maghfira, therefore, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conceals the sins of the abd and does not take him to punishment in the hereafter, despite him deserving so. But he comes to Allah asking forgiveness. And so we see that ghafara is to cover or conceal. Therefore, the maghfira of Allah is to cover the person's sins and not requite him for punishment in the hereafter. So we see that that is one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, Allah's names. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, very clear in the Quran, where for example, in Surah Nuh, where He says to us, فَكُنْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا.
Yes.
Seek forgiveness, Allah will forgive. يعني He'll conceal your sins, cover your sins, not punish you. يُرْسِلُ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّةٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will provide for you in terms of rain, in terms of children, in terms of rizq, in terms of all of these things. And it all comes down to seeking forgiveness. It all comes down to seeking forgiveness. It's very, very important. We don't realize that seeking forgiveness, istighfar, it actually ties in with rizq, as is very evident as in that verse. And it ties into rain. And for example, if there's drought, it could be because maybe not enough people are making istighfar. So we say this is very, very important name. And also tied in, evidences from the Quran is when we see, for example, dua in the Quran. When we see, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْمُسْتَغْفِنَنَ فِي الْأَسْحَارِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He's talking about those people who seek forgiveness in the last part of night, yani right before Fajr. Very, very special people, yani seeking forgiveness from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, even to the extent where Allah mentions them in the Quran. So it's very, very important, yani.
SubhanAllah. So in these days, in the beautiful days of Ramadan, just before we're having finishing off our suhoor, or before we start, you know, before the Adhan of Fajr, it's a very good time for us to do
istighfar. Absolutely, it is a very good time. And you know what, more to add to that, is the fact that the Prophet ﷺ informed us even of a hadith. in the last third of the night. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Hal min mustaghfirin," is there anyone seeking forgiveness that I may forgive him? And we were talking about special times before. You know how Friday is a special, there's a special time on Friday.
Yes.
For example, before you break your fast, if you make dua, the dua of a traveler is accepted. There's special times where if you make that dua, it's accepted. So likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in that time, in the hadith, as the Prophet informed us, is there one seeking forgiveness? Is there one seeking forgiveness that he may be forgiven? Is there one calling so that his request may be answered? And even in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly said, and even the ones who are seeking forgiveness, when? At that last portion of the night, just before Fajr.
SubhanAllah.
So the time is very, very essential. And you know why? Because at that time, many people are sleeping. Many people are sleeping and unaware. So you're getting up in the time where people are asleep, are engaged in that comfort. And you're sacrificing your bed, you're sacrificing your sleep. And you're calling, you're beseeching Allah, "Ya Allah, forgive me." You're expressing your sins. You're really connecting with Allah. You're really opening your heart to Him. You're releasing your emotions. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And this is really a purifier for the heart. The istighfar is a purifier for the heart. Even if you have done no sins, even if you have not done one single sin, istighfar is ibadah. And proof of that is the Prophet. The Prophet was ma'soom. The Prophet was sinless, alayhi salatu wasalam, before and after prophethood. Yet one narration said he would make istighfar 70 times. Allah. And another narration said he would make istighfar 100 times a day. And he was ma'soom. He was without sin. Yet he was teaching us this being a form of ibadah.
SubhanAllah. Well, you mentioned earlier the verses in Surah Nuh where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, I mean, the value of and the benefit in making istighfar. I mean, people don't really always make the connection that istighfar is linked to wealth, or istighfar is linked to children, or istighfar is linked to rain, rainfall and things like that. But subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us very clear verses within the surah of Nuh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides. When you make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives you children. So if He gives you wealth, if you're seeking wealth, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for istighfar. So subhanAllah, this is a very, very beautiful thing. And I mean, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make istighfar more than 70 or more 100 times, I mean, how many times should we be making istighfar?
Allahu Akbar. Look, this is a very good story that you mentioned, and it reminds me of this story that I looked at the other day. Abu Hanifa mentioned in his Musnad,
yes,
and he related on the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah, who he went to the Prophet and he said, "Oh Prophet of Allah," he said, I "Allah has not blessed me to bear any children. I've had no children." So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "How are you with your istighfar and sadaqah?" So then the man subhanAllah, he took the dars, he took the lesson, he understood what the Prophet was trying to say. And they said that the man increased much in his istighfar and sadaqah. And after such time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed him with 9 boys.
Allahu Akbar.
And we see that it is very, very clear that if a person, in terms of poverty, provision, drought, rain, this is all tied into istighfar. And even Imam al-Qurtubi was, I was reading in the tafsir, that in terms of drought, and in terms of provisions, in terms of children, in terms of all these things, that a person should make istighfar. This is very, very important. And in fact, the dua, a lot of the times, it does have a relation with istighfar. And we see, for example, there is one story that I do want to relate in this regard. And it's a very famous story. You've probably heard it 1,000 times, but let me just say it one more time. Ahmad ibn Hanbal.
Yes.
And we know Ahmad ibn Hanbal was a great mushtahid. He was a great imam. He was traveling in a town. He went to a town. There was nobody there in the town at that time because he got there late. So he went into the garden of the mosque. Anyway, he wanted to stay in the mosque. But the caretaker of the mosque,
he kicked him out
of the mosque. He didn't let him stay in the mosque. In the end, what happened, he saw this guy who makes dough and bread. And then he said to himself, "Let me entertain this man for the night." As he was entertained, he entertained Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal didn't say who he was. Nobody knew who he was.
Yes.
So then what happened is he saw this man making so much istighfar. So much. And so then Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he asks him. He said, "What have you seen come of this istighfar that you've been making?" He said, "There is not one dua except that Allah has accepted. But there's one that hasn't been accepted." He said, "What's that?" He said, I've been making dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to let me meet Ahmad ibn Hanbal.
Allahu Akbar.
So then what happened is, he said, subhanAllah, Allah has accepted your dua and I was even dragged into your presence. So we see that istighfar plays a very big role.
He got kicked out of the mosque, he got thrown out of the mosque, and subhanAllah, just seeking refuge, all because of that person.
All because of that individual.
Because of the person's istighfar.
Allahu Akbar.
SubhanAllah, I think we in today's society, we really undervalue the importance of istighfar in our life.
Now,
and how we need to make it something, you know, on a regular basis at the time of suhoor, you know, at the time of throughout the day, any time that we have spent waiting in a queue or traveling in a car or in a train, I mean, this is perfect time when someone can make istighfar. Is there any other time that's recommended that we make continuous
there
istighfar?
There is a time, and the time is a time of at salat. Salat is a very important time because this is as well part of the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We see that the Prophet would make istighfar, takbir, tasbih, particularly after prayer. So this is very, very important. So at our prayer times, you can make istighfar anytime. Mm-hmm. But obviously, there are specific times when we say specific things. But at the prayer time, before we sleep, in the last third of the night, there's another hadith that Imam al-Qurtubi, he mentioned in his tafsir, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waits until the half of the night is over, a third of the night is over, and then a herald comes out and he calls, is there someone seeking forgiveness? That he may be forgiven. So we see that the night time is very important, but as well the prayer times.
Yes.
After the prayer times, this is very, very important. So again, these are some of the times where we do make the istighfar.
Sheikh Hussain, I want to ask you a question. I mean, is there a particular manner of how to make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is there a particular sequence of words? I mean, how does one make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Basically, the ulama, what they said in this regard is that it's said with the tongue, but the presence of the heart. So it's said with the tongue, but the presence of the heart. So it's not just merely said on the tongue, astaghfirullah, 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 astaghfirullah. No. It should be said with the tongue, but with the presence of the heart. So there should be, yani, like a connection almost there. It should be coming from within, so to speak. But really, with respect to the words, there's a narration in Imam Muslim where he says that the Prophet ﷺ said, Astaghfirullah. And in Bukhari, in Abu Dawood, Afwan, where the Prophet ﷺ said, Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. These are very, very simple. There's obviously some long dua that was said by the Prophet ﷺ, but if a person doesn't know that dua, he can basically say, Astaghfirullah or Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. A person can also make dua. He can say, Rabbana faghfir lana dhunubana wa kaffir anna sayyi'atina. This is also mentioned in the Quran, another dua. There's a lot of other long dua, but if a person doesn't know that, he can just restrict and say, Allahumma ghfirli.
Allahumma
ghfirli. Allahumma ghfirli, warhamni, wahdini, and so on and so forth.
SubhanAllah. What about, I mean, you always hear of this dua, Sayyid al-Istighfar.
Nah.
Tell me about that, Sheikh.
This is a long istighfar. This is very, very important istighfar. If a person said it yaqeenan, muhtasiban, yani relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Jannah will definitely be his abode, as was informed by the Prophet. It's a very long dua. Basically, Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa anta khalaqtani, you have created me, wa ana abduka, and I am your servant, wa ana ala ahdika, and I am according to your covenant, wa wa'adika, مَسْتَطَعْتُ أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا صَنَعْتُ. I seek refuge with you, Ya Allah, from the evil in which I have conducted. أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ. I acknowledge your blessings upon me. عَلَيِّ وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِ فَخْفِرْ لِي. And I acknowledge that I have committed sin. فَخْفِرْ لِي. Forgive me, Ya Allah. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرَ الذُّنُوبِ إِلَّا أَنْتُ. Because nobody is going to forgive me except you. You are the one who is going to forgive me. There is nobody who can forgive except you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Sayyid al-Istighfar. This is the, so to speak, the mother of forgiveness.
Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, it's probably worthwhile, something that we should memorize and learn.
Now,
to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, you find that, I mean, in our life is full of sin. I mean, everyone will acknowledge that. No one's clear from sin. And we need to make the effort to, you know, make istighfar and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continuously, continuously, continuously. SubhanAllah, you find, Shaykh, that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when there was a fatah of Mecca,
no,
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought down Surah Al-Asr,
no,
which was an occasion where, I mean, there wasn't sin there, إِذَا جَاءَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتَحِ, until the end of the surah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. SubhanAllah, even at the time of victory, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was commanding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to make istighfar.
No.
So it seems that it's not only when you're sinning and you want to get rid of your sins, expiate your sins. It's also when you have other times, at times of victory, and we mentioned earlier, when you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for more, when you're in need of wealth, in need of children, in need of rainfall, wherever it may be. So subhanAllah, it seems that this istighfar has so much more bounties, and so much more ajr from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so much more reward.
Absolutely. Istighfar, look, it's a means of closeness to Allah, and it's a means of purifying the heart. And this is what it's really what it's all about. Purifies the heart and removes any impurities. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when a person commits a sin, a black dot stains his heart. You know what removes that black dot? Istighfar. That's what removes that black dot. How else is that black dot going to remove?
So it's a stain remover.
It's a stain remover. It's a rust remover. It's a heart cleanser. And so yes, a person, يعني he may not have committed any sin, and he may have been, but a person has to keep maintaining that continuation in his ibadah. Mm-hmm. And it just really becomes like a shield, it's a form of worship, and you constantly lead it. It's like, for example, you cannot have prayer without wudu. You cannot have prayer without wudu. Likewise, a mu'min and a believer, he is characterized as one who makes istighfar, and this is clearly shown to us by the greatest of men who ever walked, the greatest man who ever walked the earth, alayhi salatu wasalam, who constantly made it. So really, it's a purifier of the heart, it's a cleanser of the heart, it's a means of closeness to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and it is in and of itself repentance.
SubhanAllah, Shaykh. I mean, this is beautiful words and beautiful encouragement for us as well. And I mean, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged us, and just, I mean, as part of the 99 names of Allah, when you know that one of them is Al-Ghafoor, and you mentioned what was the other name that you mentioned, Sheikh?
Al-Halim.
Al-Halim, subhanAllah. I mean, what other names is there to indicate to us the importance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness?
One of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, which is closely related to Al-Ghafar, is Al-Afu. Basically, if you wanted the literal translation of that, it would mean the effacer of sins. يعني the nullifier of sin. The one who nullifies sin.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Now, some people have said that this name is very similar to Al-Ghaffar, and it is, but there's just a bit of an exception, that with the context of Al-Ghaffar or Al-Ghafoor, basically that name indicates to conceal or to cover, whereas Al-Afu is to wipe out the sin and get rid of the sin, you know, to release the sin from the person. And so therefore the person will not have punishment in the hereafter. So one is to cover and conceal, and therefore not punish in the hereafter. But one of them is to basically efface the sin and nullify the sin. So there is a unique difference when you really look at it intricately. But subhanAllah, they are different, but they're very similar. So one covers and one conceals, and the other it nullifies and wipes out the sin. And evidence to this is found in the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned in the Quran, when we said, wa'fu anna waghfir lana. So wa'fu anna waghfir lana. So we see that there is a difference between them.
Yes.
They're very similar, but there is a tiny difference between them.
SubhanAllah, wallahi, it's, yani, we are truly blessed to have a Lord like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that forgives our sins. I mean, we sin continuously, sin after sin, day after day, week after week, month after month. And then we come to the month of Ramadan, and you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opening the doors for us, closing the doors of the heavens, chaining up the shaitan, and he's opening up a channel and an opportunity to seek forgiveness from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah, you even find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the ayat of the siyam, in Surah Al-Baqarah.
No.
He tells us a beautiful ayah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عَنِّي عِبَادِي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ مُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, this is a time to supplicate.
No.
This is a time to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a time to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. Now this is very, very important, because one scholar, he went into this very, very intricately. He said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. He said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي أي عَبْدِي. عَبْدِي. My عَبْد. ليس عَبْد الدُّنْيَا. ليس عَبْد الشَّهَوَات.
SubhanAllah.
ليس عَبْد المال. Abdi, my abd, my servant, يعني the one who's dedicated to me, the one who's dedicated to me. And Allah, this is what Allah wants. Allah wants us to dedicate to Him and to turn to Him and to ask Him and to seek forgiveness from Him. This is very, very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned يعني, istighfar in the Quran so many times. And for example, the Prophet alayhi salam, when he was saying to Aisha radiallahu anha, when the Prophet taught her, where the Prophet said, "Innaka afun tuhibbu al-afa fa'fu anni." Yes. He taught us the words that you are the one who loves to pardon and forgive, so pardon. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to ask Him and wants you to request of Him. And you know what the also one point to mention here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, At-Tawwab. At-Tawwab. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna Allah yuhibbu at-tawwabin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the one who constantly makes repentance. And the ulama who gave sharah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, At-Tawwab, basically they said that this name indicates the meaning, the one who's oft returning. So it almost like implies that Allah, He knows that a person time and time will sin again. He will sin from time to time. But there you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your repentance, despite Him knowing that you're going to slip up from time to time. You see the word At-Tawwab, when you were telling me about the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, Al-Ghaffar, subhanAllah, many names relate to forgiveness. Many names relate to forgiveness. It is part of the human trait, the Muslim trait, I should say, the Muslim trait to seek forgiveness from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that I am near, if they ask, yes, indeed, my abd, if we dedicate to Allah and we ask Allah and we seek Allah's forgiveness, you will find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there to forgive.
SubhanAllah, Shaykh, wallahi, this is, no matter how much you talk about the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much He is willing to forgive us, how much He is willing to forgive us over and over and over again, you find, I mean, Muslims today, we might not be able to lower the gaze as we should, so we seek istighfar from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we might fall into the sin again, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives us again, and again, and again. And this is very different to the human quality. I mean, the human quality, once you've upset someone once or twice or three times, the guy doesn't want to deal with you anymore. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over and over. You sin and He forgives. You sin and He forgives. You sin and He forgives. And in this month of Ramadan, He's given us a beautiful opportunity. A beautiful opportunity to reconnect with Him and to have that istighfar part of our life and to train ourselves and train our tongues to have that istighfar in our lives. How is it that we can link, I mean, the taqwa that we are required to attain in the month of Ramadan with the habit of making istighfar?
Look, I think it's very important to remember what the purpose of Ramadan is in that regard. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The whole purpose of Ramadan is not just about abstaining from food and water. That's not the purpose. That's technically classified as fasting.
Yes.
It's technically classified, yes, you're fasting. But is that the whole definition of fasting? No. The definition of fasting is a lot more than that. Basically, a person can refrain. If we look at the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that a person who does not give up disobedience, then Allah is not in need of you giving up your food and water. It's very simple. So a person might give up his food and water, but if he's not going to stay away from all the types of disobedience, then really he's losing the rewards. He's missing out on the rewards. So Ramadan is about really gaining closeness to Allah. It's about taqwa. It's about bringing that in your heart. It's about being God conscious. It's about being aware. It's about refreshing that relationship with Him. But we can't... Look, wallahi, sometimes I sort of get saddened that Ramadan... And there's nothing wrong with invitation. If a person invites his family, whatever. But sometimes you see that Ramadan becomes like almost about Ramadan parties. And it leads to, wrong mixing. And then it leads to a person maybe overfilling his belly. And then it leads to missing prayer, whatever the case may be. We cannot at this time, in this period now, having reached this point in Ramadan, which the Prophet is telling us, really it's about gaining that forgiveness and maghfirah from Allah and using the opportunities and seizing the opportunities to get it. So we really can't forget that purpose as to Ramadan and the essence of it.
SubhanAllah, wallahi, it's a beautiful opportunity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to return to Him and seek forgiveness from Him and bring new habits into our life and get rid of old habits. And as you mentioned, Sheikh Wissam, that, I mean, the month of Ramadan is a month of change, a month where you want to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to repent and return to Him and get closer to Him and move away from the attractions of the dunya and try and get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and closer to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what a beautiful opportunity it's been from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us this time of forgiveness, a time where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives our sins, a time where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us, is there anything that you need? Is there anything that you want? And this is a time for us to really seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh Wissam, our time is running up, but is there anything else that you want to tell us or just try and finish off our conversation about the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we close off, inshallah?
Look, I want to say just in this regard, if we look at the example of the people that came before us, and I think it's very important that we look at their example and we study their life. If so, if we look at, for example, the life of Imam Shafi'i or Imam Abu Hanifa.
Yes.
Imam Abu Hanifa, it was said that he would recite the Quran once in the daytime and once in the Tarawih prayers at night. Now, if you look at the Quran, there's 30
ajza, yes,
20 pages each.
Yes.
Roughly every juz will take you, if you're moving at a good pace, maybe about 20, 23, 25 minutes. So it's going to take you about 7.5 hours. They were dedicating about 15 hours every single day to the recitation of Quran. Every single day. You know, when I hear about that and I learn about that, what that tells me is they dedicated utterly and absolutely to Allah and gave zero time for the world. Zero time. And they followed the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi sallam. But you see people like this, subhanAllah, they dedicated, they strove and they made use of it. And they knew who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was. And they saw him and they asked him and they just didn't sit back. People like, for example, great scholars who forgot about marriage and had to be reminded by their mothers. And the scholar would say, why didn't you remind me? Then the scholar wasn't joking. The alim wasn't joking. He was saying, why didn't you remind me, mother? I forgot about marriage. People so embedded, so in love with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. One scholar was saying, if I knew I was going to go to Jannah and not see Allah, I wouldn't want to go there. His hub was to see Allah. His love was to see Allah. They loved Allah with a passion. They loved him. Can you tell me any scenario that exists today where a master, the master and the king watches over his servants as they sleep? Never. You'll never give me an example. But look at Allah. Allah is watching over his servants. And he's the master. And he's watching over us. Wallahi, we have so much to be thankful for. And we cannot tally the favors that Allah has given us. We must include as part of our ibadah, Allah has given us this opportunity to seek his forgiveness. To seek his forgiveness. And if you know what, وَلَوْ لَفَضُّ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَكُنْتُ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And I forgot to mention that part of Allah's name, Al-Ghaffar, closely connected with that, is Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. What does Allah say? وَلَوْ لَفَضُّ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ and his rahmah لَكُنْتُ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Wallahi, if it was not for Allah's rahmah, we would be from amongst the losers. We would be lost. We have, you know what? Allah benefits nothing by us making istighfar. Nothing. He benefits zero from us. He doesn't need us. He'll wipe us out in an instance if he wants. We benefit. And Allah creates the opportunity. And this is part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, with respect to his names, At-Tawwab, Al-Halim, that he creates those opportunities for us to move closer to him. We need Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. He does not need us. We need to take these opportunities to move close to him. We need to undertake these opportunities and seek the istighfar. Otherwise, we will be from amongst the losers. And I think it's very, very important to remember that we need Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala.
SubhanAllah, Sheikh. Just before we finish up, you reminded me of something that when you're talking about the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ulama say, you know, when you're exiting the toilet, one of the adwa that you say, ghufranak. And one of the ulama, he went to the interpretation to say that we say ghufranak because of our lack of ability to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing he just gave us inside, the ability to pass.
No.
SubhanAllah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us ad'iyah that have because we can't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his blessings, so we ask him for forgiveness. We seek his forgiveness. Sheikh Wissam Chikawi, jazakallahu khair for being with us tonight. Our dear listeners, jazakumullah khair for tuning in. You've been with the Deen team. I hope that you've benefited from today's show. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our Ramadan a blessed Ramadan and to give us the true forgiveness and give us his mercy and give us salvation from hellfire. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Until next time, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.